Hi guys, today we are going to discuss about the design for X and design center model. Design of X. X is nothing but your manufacturability of the product, assembly of the product, reliability of the product, maintainability of the product, serviceability of the product, environment aspects with related to your product, and life cycle cost of your product. First, we are going to discuss about the design for manufacturability. That is nothing but your DFM. It is the general engineering art of designing product in such a way that they are easy to manufacture. That means whatever the possibilities are there are the easy way to fabricate your product. So design of engineering a product in order to facilitate the manufacturing engineering process. It will reduce the manufacturing cost of your product. Designers should consider the type of raw material and the form of raw material going to use. Optimize all the manufacturing functions, that means your fabrication, assembly, test, shipping, delivery, service and repair, and assure the best cost, quality, reliability, regulatory compliance, safety, time to market and customer satisfaction. Now we are going to discuss about the DFM guidelines. The first one, simplify the design and reduce the number of parts. If your number of parts is reduced, the cost of your product will reduce, as well as the time consumption for the product will reduce, and the less maintenance, that means less number of parts is there, means less maintenance will come into the picture. So if less parts implies less purchases, inventory, handling, processing time, development time, equipment, engineering time, assembly difficulty, service inspection and testing, etc. And second one, we have to develop a modular design. That means the use of your models in the product design simplifying manufacturing activities such as inspection, testing, assembly, purchasing, redesign, maintenance, service and so on. Suppose if any product, that means any part of the product is failed, we have to easily replace the part. So like that, we have to develop our design. Third one, use of standard components. Standard components are less expensive than custom made items. The high availability of these components reduce the product lead times. Also, their reliability factors as well as the asset time. Furthermore, the use of your standard components refer to the production pressure to the supplier, relieving in part manufacturing concern of the meeting production schedules. That means if you are using the standard component, there is no need of investing time and cost of product in the company. That we are using the standard components, we can able to reduce the workload to the team, as well as instead of developing or making lot of R&D in developing a new product, we can able to easily use the other company product or other standard product for the development. And design of parts to be multifunctional. So multifunction parts reduce the total number of parts in design, thus obtaining the benefits given in the role. Suppose if you take the chassis, so depends upon the customer, on the chassis they will fix various assemblies. So the Tata company or whatever the automobile company, they are not making the bodybuilding, they are only making the chassis and they will give to the customers. If you are taking the engine, you can able to use for your vehicle or you can able to use for your agriculture equipments. Like that we can able to use. Design for fourth point, design for easier fabrication. Select the optimum combination between the material and fabrication process to minimize the overall manufacturing cost. In general, the final operations such as painting, polishing, finishing, machining, etc. should be avoided. Excessive tolerance, surface finish requirement and so on are commonly found problems that result in higher than the necessary production cost. Fifth one, provide tolerance. Each manufacturing process has an inherent ability to maintain a certain range of tolerances and to produce a certain rough finishes. So to achieve these tolerances outside of the normal range requires special processing that typically results in exponential increase in their manufacturing cost. Now we are going to discuss about the design of assembly. To maximize the ease of your assembly, part is inserted from the top. If the part is self-aligned, we can able to easily assemble the part. Part does not need to be oriented and the part requires only one handed for assembly. Part requires no tool. That means the part is assembled in a single linear motion. Then part is secured immediately upon the insertion. So if you see the various examples of the part, how we can able to make, that means a unidirectional, it should be visibility, unidirectional instruction, as well as your nut and bolts assembly, as well as fixing. Next one, design of reliability. Reliability is defined as the probability that a component, equipment or a system will satisfactorily perform its intended function under the given success. That means whatever the product we are developing, it should fulfill the customer requirement. If the customer is not satisfied, the product will lead to failure. For improving the reliability, making the failures less like to happen in the first place. That means by maintaining the equipments properly or fitting more reliable equipment. And second one, making changes such as the overall system continue to function satisfactory even when failures. That means by fitting the standby equipment. Suppose if you are taking a car, you can't able to give spare for your engine, but you can able to give spare for your tire. Tire, that means it's depend upon the environment, but engine performance is mainly the depends upon the customer maintenance. So that's why the companies are not giving the spare engine, they are giving the spare tires. Next, we are going to discuss about the design for maintainability and survivability. The objective of design for maintainability is to assure that the design will perform satisfactorily throughout its intended life with a minimum expenditure of budget and effort. So DFM, DFS and DFR are related to, because minimizing the maintenance and facilitating the service can be achieved by improving reliability. An effective DFM minimizes the downtime for maintenance. An effective DFM minimizes the downtime for the maintenance, user and technician maintenance time, personal engineers resulting from the maintenance task, cost resulting from maintainability features, and the logistical requirement for replacements of parts, backup units, and your personals. And next part is your design for your environment. That means if you are design for the environment is a design approach to reduce the overall human health and environmental impact of the product, process or services, where impacts are considered across its life cycle. So design for your environmental processing and manufacturing, design for your environmental packing, design for your disposal or reuse, or design for your energy efficiency. These are the factors we have to consider while designing your product. That means the factors related to the environmental impact.
When it comes to sustainability, how your product ends its life is often as important as how it lives. Will your product spend thousands of years trapped in a landfill, along with the valuable raw materials it contains? Or will it get reincarnated into a new product right away, requiring less material to be dug up somewhere else? Well, that all depends on how you design it. Some products are easy to design for end of life. You can choose not to mix a bunch of materials together, like you see in a typical juice box. Instead, use an aluminum can, a single simple material that's recyclable everywhere. But what about something like a laptop? That's more complicated. How it ends its life depends largely on how easy it is to disassemble. If your laptop is difficult or intimidating to take apart, chances are its next stop is the dump. If accessing its components and materials is easy, all kinds of possibilities open up. Maybe its user will take it in for repair or upgrade instead of throwing it away. Or maybe an e-waste recycler will extract the valuable metals and plastics without letting any toxins escape. Whatever the case, it's a race against the clock. Users want convenience. Recyclers have a very limited time to separate materials and remove hazardous components. Let's start by looking at some simple strategies to design for disassembly. Many of them will even make manufacturing cheaper. First, the fewer parts you use, the less there is to take apart. For example, you could integrate all the separate keys of a keyboard into one flexible piece. Beyond this, it's an obsession with fastening. And as with parts, the fewer fasteners you use, the better. Use common and similar fasteners that require only a few standard tools for disassembly. This helps save time. Screws are faster than nuts and bolts. Use nuts and bolts only where screws might strip threads because of repeated use or high stresses. Even better, use snap-together hooks or tab and slot fasteners that don't require any tools, but make them intuitive and ensure that they can be done and undone many times without breaking. You can minimize fasteners by using a single set to hold down several layers of parts. Also, make sure fasteners are easy to see and accessible on a single axis so the part doesn't have to be flipped over. Don't use tight press fits. Friction fits that can be reversed by hand are better. Avoid glues. If you absolutely need them, use adhesives that are heat reversible or dissolve in common non-toxic solutions like water. Finally, build disassembly instructions into the product. If the parts themselves have pictures or text showing how to take them apart, anyone can do it. The more of these strategies you use, the faster and easier your products will be to take apart. If it's easy enough, your product can win the race against the clock. While this can lead to a longer useful life by making repair and upgrade easier, no matter how clever we are, our products will reach the end of their lives eventually. And that's where a new responsibility begins. We need to make sure that anything that can't be safely and quickly broken down by our natural ecology is easy to return to the industrial ecology. There, it can be reused or recycled into other valuable products. Whether this happens depends largely on how you design both the product and the take-back system. Here's some strategies to help. First, minimize the number of different kinds of materials and components for faster and easier sorting. Often, recyclers shred products and then the particles are sorted by machine. The fewer different kinds of materials, the easier they are to sort. And it's also important to easily identify and quickly remove hazardous or valuable components that shouldn't be shredded, like batteries, screens, and circuit boards. The materials you do use should be commonly recycled and clearly labeled in case they're dealt with by hand. For plastics, avoid paints, other coatings, and adhesives because they can contaminate the material. Inherent color can be okay, particularly common colors like black. Now, not all recycling is created equal. Some materials can only be downcycled and converted into lower value items. Plastic comes in so many different types with so many additives and colorants, they often just get bundled together and downcycled. The best recycling allows materials to come back in their new life with the same value they had in their last life. Maybe even higher value. Even the best designed product will only get you so far, though, if there's no recycling program to take it. So design your product with this larger system in mind. Manufacturers are starting to be held accountable for the waste their products produce, especially when it's toxic. This is called extended producer responsibility and requires many to offer take-back programs. Using these strategies to make your product recyclable will live up to that responsibility and divert material from the dump. Sometimes you can even do better than recycling by reusing whole components rather than just materials. This is known as remanufacturing, and you can design for it with these same strategies. It not only uses less energy and causes less waste, it can also be more profitable. It's already common in some industries. For example, the auto industry remanufactures engine blocks. So, it's up to you. Do you want your product to languish in a landfill or to find new life when its first life ends? These strategies make it easy to design a great end of life for your product. Many of them can also be used to push that end of life farther into the future through repair and upgrade. And that's what we'll look at next in our quest to build the most sustainable products.